Okay, it's time to do a update on DIYLC, Do-It-Yourself Layout Creator. I did one a long time ago, but there's been a bunch of program changes and a bunch of stuff I didn't explain in the menus. I'm going to go through the menus here. First of all, I have a blank canvas on here because I said new. That's a new project you're starting. And here you can give it a title, put some words for description, your author name, the width in inches or other measurements here of your workspace. That's this white area right here. And the height, the width and the height of this white area. And if you're going to use a grid, set the grid spacing. Different measurements for that too. And the default font you like to use, I'll tell you this. This square 721 BT works really well for adding text to small components like resistors and stuff like that. So I use that one and your default font size. So that's for this project here. I'm going to go through these menu items up here. So let's say we want to open an existing file. I've got a demo file in here somewhere already. And here it is. Okay. You could continue working on this file, or if somebody gives you a DIY file, you can open it, change things, and make it your own. Or, let's start with a new canvas again here. Here's how you can, if you have a drawing going and you want to import a section of another drawing, find a DIY file, and I just imported these that were in a DIY file. So if I had, let me get rid of that. If I had, I don't want to do that. Let's open my demo again here. Okay, and now I want to import something else into this drawing here. Let's try that 9-pin belt and socket. And here it is, put it right down here. You need to make a bigger workspace if you're going to try to import a big drawing, but so I just imported this into this drawing. So that's what that is. Get rid of all that. Here's how you would save. And it saves to a DIY file. Save as a different name, of course. So this is a demo. I could save it as anything I wanted there, a different name. Recent files that you've opened. It's a quick way to get back to something in the menu here. Okay, you can export this whole DIY file into a PDF, which I've done here, called Demo PDF. Ask me if I want to replace it. This is handy to give to other people that don't have DIYLC. Let's see, where is it in the menu here? Demo PDF, here's the file I just exported. Now it's opening in Adobe Acrobat as a PDF file right here. And by the way, this exporting to a PDF file is the best way to print your diagrams because you can get a 100% scale way better in Adobe than you can trying to print from DIYLC. So if you wanted to get this printed at 100% and lay it down on a circuit board, say, and make drill marks where all these eyelet holes are, that's the way to do it with a PDF file. So you can also export it to just a image file, and I will do that now. I've already done this before, so here it is over. Here's the demo PDF that I did before. I forgot that it's on my second screen. I have to drag it over here for you to see it. Now I'm going to open this image file. Now it's opening in my image program, which is PaintShop Pro, as a PNG file. So there's a couple ways to export your drawing. Export to a PDF Adobe file or or an image file. Now printing, you can print from DIYLC, but it's very difficult to get it to do at 100%. If you want to be able to use this as a template to lay down on another circuit board. So I really recommend doing it as a PDF and then printing from there. Trace mask, I don't really use that. The guys that do copper trace boards use this a lot. Most of us guys here are doing eyelet board or turret boards, just really crude terminals like this that are drilled and a terminal's installed. So I've never actually used trace masks. The PC board guys probably do, and they could explain that better, and I don't really know. The same with analyzing and all this. This is more generated towards copper trace PC board guys, I guess. Don't use it. Integration. This is how you import building blocks and invariants, or export them and give these files to other people or import their files. So a building block is let's use this 9-pin belt and socket down here. This is a building block. It's been drawn out and connection points have been put on it. Then all this collection of items are saved as a building block. So it's a collection of things grouped together and saved as a building block, basically. And here's my building blocks. And here's how you would export that. Let's say export a building block, give to somebody. Here's all my building blocks. Let's say I want to do that 9-pin belt and socket. Check it. And it's going to save as building blocks by DLH. You can say change it to any name you want. And now it's in a DIY file. Ooh, I lost the link to that. Where is it here? That's not where it's at. Dang, sorry guys. Well, anyways, save it to the location you can find it. So let's import one of those. Let's import a building block. Let's import the one I just exported, although this would be another one someone else gave you. A building block. One building block was imported, and it was this 9-pin belt and socket up here that I exported, and it imported another copy of it here. You can right-click and delete that building block. So that's building blocks. Integration. Variants are, if you create, let's say, resistors, different resistors, which are down in passive components, resistors. Look over here. This, see that plus 14 next to it? There are 14 variants for resistors in my file. Now, some of these came with DIYLC. You can't save those. They're already part of the program. But this particular 3-watt is one that I've created, and this 5-watt and this 100K carbon comp is one. So if I wanted to export my variants, they're in this list here. Let's say resistors. And it's going to save as variants by me. I'm going to replace it. Now let's go back to integration and import variants. There's that file right there. It would obviously have other things in it you wanted to import. You wouldn't import the same thing again, because what it did down here is add my variants again to my list. And by the way, there's you don't have to start from scratch on a lot of these components you're seeing in my drawings here, like capacitors and stuff, because I have a library of components. I'm going to drag this window over here, and it's right here at this address. And you can go in here, and here's actual DIY files of all the fender boards that I make. So you can import those. You don't have to start from scratch on any of these here. And then all the Hoffman turret boards I make are in the library also. These are actual DIY files, miscellaneous DIY files. We've got a bunch over here, including some of Rob Robinette's files. And then here's where the template files are, the XML files. So Here's building blocks, miscellaneous coupling caps, electrolytic caps. You'll see like Sprague's and Mallory and all that in here. So make sure you use my library. Here's the address, and it's linked on every one of my web pages to go to this library here where you can download these things. All right, let's keep going here. File menu. We've done the integration. Exit the program. That's okay. Let's do something here. Let's say we click on this part, and let me close this over here. And we want to transform the selection. I think it's easier to do this by right-clicking on the part, and all these things you can do to that part are in this menu. So rotate a part clockwise, transform, mirror it. Mirror it means to swap it left to right, or horizontally, or vertically. Right-click on it again, transform, nudge it, move it slightly in its position, send it backward or forward. I'm going to explain that in a second here. Okay, so you see how this is an eyelet. Let's zoom in here. And it is in front of this blue wire right here. This is how you bring things forward or send it backward. And the resistor is in front of the eyelet. So let's take the eyelet, right click, and then transform, send it backwards. Okay, see now how it's in back of everything? So that's how you get it to look like this. This is a jumper wire. I want it behind the eyelet, and I want the resistor in front of the eyelet. So that's how you get things moved forward. See, this under the board wire is underneath this resistor. If I right click and I transform it and bring it forward, now it's on top of the resistor and on top of this over here. So that's how that works. So click on a part, get this menu selection down here. You can also duplicate this part and see it put this other resistor right there. But what it didn't do is duplicate the name I gave it. I'm going to go through that menu in a minute here. Okay, back to transforming. Let's say you want to, let's select this and that part. Now I've got three things selected here, two eyelets and a jumper. You can transform and group that. Now it's a group of three items. You can copy it and paste it. See how it copied everything? That's what grouping is, or ungrouping. Transform, ungroup that selection. Now all these things are back to being individual items. They aren't grouped anymore. All right, let's go back to check this menu, right-click menu again. Okay, so let's say I change this, the color or something about the part. Double-clicking on it, by the way, brings up all this. Let's say I want to change the color, and I want it to be red. Probably going to be ugly, but that's the color. Now, right-click on it, and save that as a variant. Call it red resistor. Now we go over to our passive components where resistors are. Pull down the menu and look, or actually right-click on it, I'm sorry. Whoops, right-click on it. See how red resistor is down here? I've saved it as a variant. So if I click on red resistor, click in two places to put it where you want it. There's my red resistor. So that's what a variant is. So if you created a bunch of different resistors and made it variants, you wouldn't have to go in and change all these things to it. By the way, double-clicking on something brings up this menu here. Here's where the borders and the colors and the color coding band is for that resistor. Display the name of the resistor, and the name is the generic thing it chose, but I can change this to, let's say, 10K. It's not labeled as a 10K. But now see the name says 10K here. And then power rating for that resistor. So if you make a new variant and change all these things and then save it, all this information is saved also. Okay, let's see, where were we? We went through pretty much all the transforms, I think, yeah. All right, now this resistor, all right, we saved this red resistor. Let's apply a variant to it. Let's make it into a half-watt carbon film. So what I did to that red resistor was apply a variant to it. So let's say I mistakenly pasted one variant. I can pick any one of these and transform that resistor into another variant. That's going to look weird because it's too small to be a 5-watt body, so I had to grab it and expand it. Apply a variant. Let's make it into a 3-watter. There's a 3-watter. So, say if I go too short, though, it looks goofy because the body of that resistor is bigger than that. It's this. There's the minimum it can be, because it's a big 3-watt resistor. That's a right-click again. We went through variants. Save your variant. Apply a variant to something. I don't use this. I tried doing this one time, and it hung up DIYLC for a long time, so I don't really use it for anything. So that transform was up here in the edit menu, but like I said, right-clicking brings up it over here. I like using that better. Renumber selections. If you do this, you're going to find that it's going to mess up your name. So this 100K is named 100K right here because I want 100K to display on that, but I have it selected right now. And if I go renumber, it's going to change it back and mess up my name on there. But if you used R1, R2, R3, R4, blah, 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 and you inserted another resistor right here and called it R5, it would go through and renumber R1, R2. This would become R3 if you did it left or right. So that's what that renumbering is. I don't really use it. You can choose renumber from top to bottom or left to right on your drawing. So your project settings, that's what you filled out when you first created a new drawing, but you can come back and change them anytime you want. All right, we did file menu, we did edit menu. And here's your undo, by the way, if you mess up, undo or redo something. Cut, copy, and paste, but all that's available, well, most of it, by right-clicking. So let's see, config menu, anti-aliasing just gives you less fuzzy edges around your drawing here. Let's zoom in on this. I'm at maximum zoom here, but you see the little spiky things on here? Now it's all smooth. That's what anti-aliasing is. You can create new pads on your drawing every time you do something. I don't really use that. Auto edit mode, I don't remember what that's for. Some of these things I don't use. Continuous creation is handy. If you check that and you do this, create this capacitor, do it again, it just keeps creating the same part. That's what auto or continuous creation is. Export your grid, I don't use that. Extra working area, if you make this white area too small here, you can get an extra big work area around the edge of your drawing there. Hardware acceleration, do not check this. If you check this, my computer comes to a crawl. DIYLC comes to a crawl. I have a second monitor over here. If I drag DIYLC to that monitor, it's completely black. It doesn't work on my computer. So make sure, if you ever have issues, make sure this is unchecked. High quality rendering just gives you a better image. Oh, this is pretty cool. Highlight connected areas. Okay. You see how I have this eyelet connected with a jumper, to this eyelet, and then this under the board wire goes all the way over to this eyelet. Here's what happens when you highlight connected areas. Click that. Now let's click on this. See how these two turn green because they're connected together? Now follow the jumper wire. That's all connected together, and it highlights connected together areas. This whole area is connected together. Click on that. All four or five of these, or six eyelets, are connected together now. Shows you that. Same with anything that's connected together here. See, these three are connected together. It's a pretty handy little feature. So that's what highlight connected areas. Mouse wheel zoom is just rolling the mouse wheel and zooming in and out. Outline mode does a primitive kind of outline of your components like this. That's what that is. Show the rulers on the edges of your drawing. Rulers are back. Show the grid. If I zoom in, there's no grid showing. The grid was what you set up over here in your project settings. Show the grid. It's back. I have a real tiny grid. Snap to grid means that this part will... Ooh, I gotta turn off highlight connected areas here. Okay, as I move this, it's gonna snap to a center point of one of these grid markers here. If you don't have it on, you can move it anywhere, but let's change my grid to a fatter grid here. Let's say my grid is a quarter of an inch, let's say. All right, and I have snap to grid on. Now, see, it's kind of hard to see, but you see the grid markings here? This thing is going to snap right to the next point. Nothing in between that. So snap to grids are a real handy way to get everything lined up real nice and neat. If you don't have snap to grid on, you can move this anywhere you want. And I'm going, oh, let's put that there. Oh, that's ugly. It actually is supposed to be right in the middle of that wire. So if your snap to grid was set and all these parts were snapping to that grid, you can get them lined up real nice and pretty. All right, here. Snap to grid back on. Sticky points. This is cool too. So I have this resistor. Oops, let me move this up here. By the way, the arrow keys on your keyboard are a handier way to move the drawing around than grabbing it with the mouse. Let's get rid of this component here. Sticky points. That means if I go to move this eyelet and sticky points are on, everything connected to that eyelet moves with it. Okay? That's pretty cool. Turn sticky points off. Now I can just move the eyelet. By the way, I made my snap to grid really big. And it's snapping to that quarter inch grid there. So that's why it's doing that. Theme just changed the overall coloring theme of the whole DIYLC toolbox. I don't really use this too much, so I can't tell you what that's all about. Layers. All right, parts are on their own layers, okay? So here's how you make a layer visible or invisible or lock it so you can't move something. Okay, so the board is this here. Let's say I make my board not visible. See how it disappeared? Now it's back again. Now let's say I take the board and I unlock it. Now I can move that board around, and it comes back to its full color. And by the way, if you can't see some of your components, it's because you need to move the board all the way backward. Because you may have put a part there and you can't see it, it might be behind the board. So move the board all the way down and then everything else will be on top of it. So let's move this board forward. Bring forward. Okay, now the board's on top of everything. You can't see it. Just a little tip there. So back to layers. I'm going to lock it. and the board kind of becomes transparent, and I can't grab it and move it. The same with anything else on these other layers. Traces. You notice all my eyelets disappeared. Now they're back. Copper traces and things on the connectivity menu are on that layer. And if you don't want something to move, you can lock it all. Now I can't grab these eyelets and move them, but I can move the parts because they're on a different layer. All right, components, visible. See, they're all gone. Now you can see the board and the eyelets and anything else that's not on the component layer. It's back again, and but same thing. Lock them down so you can't grab this resistor and move it by accident. Text. All the text has disappeared because I made it invisible, and it's back. So that's what layers are. Project Cloud, you can send your projects up to the cloud. Upload it if you sign up for an account there. It's free. You can download other people's projects from the cloud. Manage all your uploads. So, I don't really use the cloud. You can search for projects on the cloud. There's a lot of stuff on there. Help menu. Here's your user manual. It's not really that complete. I'm going to drag the browser over here. User manual goes to this link. And there's some stuff in here. Covers a lot of what I did and actually some things I didn't cover. By the way, back to... I'll leave this on the screen a second. Like I said, this link is on every one of my website pages, and it's the link to the DIYLC layout library on my website. And on my AMP forum, I have a whole board for DIYLC layout creator there with a bunch of tips. And if there's any sort of installation issues, you can find stuff here about that. Other posts down here. So make sure you check that on my AMP forum. AMP forum link is on every one of my web pages. And this is just one board in my AMP forum. And it is down here. There's a bunch of different boards. That was the manual. We went through that. There's also a Facebook page for DIYLC Layout Creator. If you're into Facebook, I post there, but I also post the tips and stuff on my AMP forum here when I come up with something, because Facebook is not really a good place to store things. It stays permanently here where you can see it in a menu on a forum. Facebook, it rolls off the screen, never to be seen again most of the time. And I think, let's see here, I think that's about it. Oh, by the way, everything you've saved to DIYLC, your variants, your building blocks, are all in your config file. If you go to make some major change, you can copy your config file and make a backup of it in case you want to go back to that config if something gets messed up or you change something drastically. And on Windows 9 Pro, where I am, this is where my DIYLC config is stored. And it, so users accounts, my account, .DIYLC in this folder. And then DIYLC makes its own backups every time you stop and start it. You can go ahead and delete these backups, but I believe they'll delete after so many days. I can't remember what the criteria is. So here are backups of your DIY file that you've been working on. Logs, if there's an issue, it's in this folder here. You can look at a log if there's some sort of problem. But there's your config file. Right click, copy, make a backup of it. If you ever install a new version or something, it's a good idea, I think, before installing a new version to make a copy of your config file. And if you open it, No wonder I've been showing it off in the wrong window here. Sorry, I forget that I'm on a dual monitor. It's over here. Sorry, folks. Here's where it's located. C users on Windows 9 Pro. DIYLC. Here's my config file. Here's the backup I just made that you couldn't see while I was talking. Here's where all the files make their own backups in here. And a log. If there's something wrong, you can go there. So, like I said before, right-click, copy, and here's how you make a copy of your config file before you install a new version or do something drastic to DIYLC. And by the way, let's start a new file here. I mentioned my library. If I want to open something from the library, let's see here, where was it? I got to do it by date because I downloaded this from my DIYLC library. It's a Fender AB763, no reverb. And it's one of my eyelet boards that I make on HoffmanAmps.com. So you can take any one of the Fenders, and let's say you want to add some eyelets, right click, copy, change some things around, and make it your own, and then save it, and have this made as a custom board. I make custom boards from your DIYLC files, and I have a separate video on that. Go to my forum, the DIYLC board, and look for the link on how to have your own custom boards made. And I make them from wherever you put these holes on your board. That's where a hole is going to get drilled and a terminal is installed. You can have turret lugs or eyelets made. So make sure you check out that video. And on YouTube, I have a whole DIYLC playlist with a bunch of DIYLC videos. You're going to be watching this on YouTube, so make sure you check the comments. I'll put some links down below for that. And I believe I've covered everything today. I haven't got into editing files. I've like creating and doing all this stuff here. That's a whole separate video, and I have done that before. So again, make sure you check YouTube playlist and look for that video. I may do an updated one in the future. I'll have to go back and look at that old video and see if it's still good or some things need to be changed or updated. But that's it for DIYLC update today. Okay, it's time to do an update on...